Today we have a beetle race. Beetle yellow and beetle red are stuck to this platform, and this platform is rotating at a fixed speed. But who's faster? Is beetle red faster or is beetle yellow faster? The answer to this question is at the end of this lesson. But before we find that, let's look at some basic concepts of rotational motion. See, each of these rotating objects have a fixed axis. You have an axis over here about which this is rotating. There's an axis about which the fan is rotating, and the axis is fixed because it is at rest with respect to the surface of the earth. All of them are rigid bodies. The shape or size of these objects don't change as they rotate. So we've actually simplified things a little when we say that we are considering only rigid bodies and bodies that rotate about a fixed axis. Moving on further, you can see that as the object rotates, each point on the object is in circular motion. Now, let me just describe the motion of a point P, say, that moves along this circular path. And let me just choose four points on the circle to represent the point as it moves along the circle. Let's say A, B, C, and D. To be a little more specific, let me just write down the X and Y coordinates of these points. Let's say A is at 3, 2, the X and the Y coordinate. This is negative X. You have to tell me a way in which I can specify these positions on the circle using just one quantity. If I am using X and Y coordinates, I'll count this as 2. And I want to use just one quantity. Thought of something? Yes, I think you've guessed correctly. See, the angle that this line OP, if I join this over here to the center of the circle, the angle that the line OP makes with the x-axis can give me the position of the point P. Let's say A is at, and let's say this angle is 33.7 degrees. And for B, let's say the angle. Now, I'm specifying the angular position of a point on the circle, but I'm using just one quantity, and that quantity is the angle theta, which the line OP makes with the x axis. Now, you've probably also noticed that this angular coordinate could be either positive or it could be negative. See, the sign convention is the same that we use in trigonometry, that displacements in the anti-clockwise direction are positive and in the clockwise direction are negative. Now, if you just recall motion along a straight line, then you will remember that x in linear motion is used to specify position, whereas here in rotational motion we are using the angular coordinate, which we call theta. So theta gives me the angular position in rotational motion. So this is linear position and this is angular position. However, there is one point we need to take note of while describing rotational motion. See, I have used theta in degrees over here. I have mentioned the angles in degrees. But normally in rotational motion, we will use all angles in radians. And we will not use angles, we will not specify angles in degrees. The relation between degrees and radians is 360 degrees is 2 pi radians. And I'm sure you want to ask me, why do we do this? Why do we use radians and why do we not use degrees? See, the reason for that is, say I take a circle over here and this is an arc length S. Say this is the arc length S. And this is the radius r, and this angle is theta. Now, I can write theta equals arc length upon radius, or I can say S is equal to R times theta. See, S is the arc length and theta is the angular displacement. So this gives us a relation between the distance moved along the circle and the angle covered at the center of the circle. Okay, now let's just quickly summarize what we've done so far. X is the distance moved in linear displacement. Theta is the angular rotation, which is the theta is the angular displacement. And the relation between the linear distance and the angular motion will be S is equal to R times theta. Now that we've talked of displacement, the next obvious quantity that we look at is velocity. Now, the speed v of the rotating particle, suppose you have a particle rotating around this circle, then the speed v is the distance covered, let's say it covers an arc length s, in time t. So, the speed v of the particle will be distance covered over time taken. As the particle moves from this position, you can see that it has made an angular displacement theta, time interval t. So I could write the angular velocity omega as the final angle theta 2 minus theta 1 over the time interval, which I can say t2 minus t1. t2 and t1 are the two instants of time. In that case, what I see, actually, if I take this as the x-axis and this as the initial angular position theta 1 and this as the final angular position theta 2, then you can see theta 2 minus theta 1 gives me the angular displacement, which is theta, which can be denoted as delta theta over delta t. This value is an average value. Now, instead of an average value, see, I am looking at an instantaneous value. What do you mean by an instantaneous value? Which means I don't want the velocity over a certain time interval. I want the velocity at every instant of time, when the particle is here and then when it is here and then when it is here. So now what I need is an instantaneous value. So to find the instantaneous value, which means I'm going to take the time interval delta t to be very small. So I say delta t tends to 0, and in that case I say omega is equal to d theta by dt. See, we're using calculus over here, but it's not difficult to understand. If I need the velocity at a certain instant of time, then I have to make this time interval as small as possible. Because if the time interval stays large, then I get the velocity, but I get an average value, because I get a velocity over a certain time interval. Now, if I can make that time interval as small as possible, if I make it as small as possible, which means it tends to zero, then the value that I find is called an instantaneous value, or it gives me the velocity at every instant of time. Now, if you look at this table, you can see that linear motion and rotational motion have analogous quantities and there is a certain relation between them. So now, if you want to derive a relation between the linear velocity v and the angular velocity omega, then how do you think you would do that? And the hint is, you have to look at the relation between the linear displacement and the angular displacement. So let's just take a look at that. We'll begin with this relation. So we have S is equal to R times theta. If I divide both sides by the time interval t, I get S by t equal to R times theta over t. Now, distance over time is the velocity. R is the radius of the circle in which the particle moves, and theta over t is the angular velocity omega. Okay, now I can do the same steps if I use calculus. So you start with S is equal to R times theta. Now, if I take the time derivative of s, I have ds over dt equals r, since r is a constant, r times d theta over dt. ds over dt is the velocity, so v is equal to r times omega. Now, let's just put these quantities into the table over here. We have v, which is equal to dx by dt, which is the linear velocity. We have omega, which is equal to d theta by dt, and we have a relation between them, which is equal to v is equal to r times omega. And you can see very clearly that each time in the relation we will have r. See, as we work further on this table, you will find that each time we relate the linear and the angular quantities, we will have r, the radius of the circular path, coming in. Now let's look at the race that we talked about at the beginning of the lesson. If beetle yellow was yours, then you won. Congratulations!